Good evening. On Tonight with Tim Modise, we celebrate the life of the fallen icon, Hugh Masekela, with friends Caiphus Semenya and Sipho Hotstix Mabuza. We'll also review the Eskom inquiry with Mr. Sikonati Manchanja of the Financial Mail. On the 23rd of January, the world woke up to the news of the death of Hugh Masekela following a protracted battle with cancer. With a career spanning more than 60 years, Brahu became the face of South African music throughout the world. He went into exile in the early 60s and returned home in 1990 to huge acclaim and celebration. He put up a big musical production called Sekunjalo, went on to record and perform with a wide variety of musicians from across the world. Masekela led a multidimensional life, regarded by many as the ambassador of African music, a mentor, an activist, and the pride of his family and friends. He rubbed shoulders with the powerful, entertained fans globally, and socialized with the ordinary. Tonight I'm joined by his lifelong friend and musical icon in his own right, Caiphus Semenya, as well as protege and music superstar Sipho Hotstix Mabuza. Good evening to you, gentlemen.
Good evening. Good evening.
And a pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you.
On the program. You know, we're supposed to feel sad, but at the same time, I'm sure we're feeling glad, happy, alive, that we're going to be talking about somebody we knew very well. You were very closer to him than many of us, but for those of us who interacted with him, however brief the moments were, they were always joyful moments. And I was talking to you, Hotstix, about how you got to know Brahu. As it happens, you know him through Brakatsi here, who's sitting next to you. But tell me the story.
Yeah. Well, again, you know, I also want to talk about, you know, the pain. The pain will always be there as much as we're celebrating.
Yes.
But in 1976, Brakatsi and Sisleta came to Botswana. I think they were invited to come and raise funds for the BCM movement, the student movement. And they didn't have a drummer, but the Beatles were also invited to come in as a support act for the gig. So Brakatsi was a bit worried because he'd never known many South African musicians at that. He'd been away for some time. And when I was introduced to him, one of the things that Brakatsi said to me, I said, Emma, because he'd never heard, I mean, Bobrakati Batamila Hulala Bo Eli Mabuza and all those, you know, those were their dramas.
Yes.
They were quite comfortable with those. So here it is, a young musician from a pop group called the Beatles being brought in to come and play his music. But I don't think Caiphus was very much aware that we were always listening to their music.
Yes.
Now there was this track which he had put me to challenge, this Arrange.
Yeah.
You know.
I remember
and
that.
That's the first song. That's the first song. The first song he said to me, can you play Arrange? It's a 6/8 time thing.
Yeah.
But you know, Brakatsi's times have got all these complexities and stuff. And I played.
And
he looked at CC. And I remember he looked at Leta and looked at all the, there was Dudu Pukwana, there was Kent Brinkley, and Emil
Latimore. Jonas Gwanga.
And Bra Jonas, yes. And Brakatsi says, hey, why is it Hotamika? Because, well, you know, I had developed more as a jazz drummer, so I was able to do some of these things. And of course, we started touring. I toured with Brakatsi and Sisi and the band as a drummer.
Yes. Yeah.
And then subsequently, when Brakatsi went to the States, he actually wanted me to come to the States and join him.
Yeah.
And apparently what Brakatsi did then, he informed you, he says, hey,
you must meet
this young man.
Yes.
You know, he's an amazing drummer and so on. And then of course, coincidentally, Selby, who was in the band, happens to have been Ebra Hugh's cousin. Mm-hmm. And that way, Hugh decided, how? I want to see these guys. Miriam had recorded one of the songs that we had composed, Inhlupheko Ipheli. And that's how the whole relationship got
started
and so on.
Mm.
Yeah. And
well, you know, as I said, it's both sad but also we're celebrating a life well lived and huge contributions on the part of Hugh Masekela. He's a lifelong friend of yours. And you saw him, you know, the final days as well. Paying him visits, and was he in good spirits the last time you saw him?
Yeah, he was an optimist. You know, was very optimistic about life. And me and Grandma, we went a couple of times, not a couple of times, but several days, you know, just before he passed on. And we could see that he was in pain. Mm. But every time we were together, you know, we stopped talking pain.
Yes.
We talked, you know, life, we talked future, we talked this, you know, and that. And we knew somehow, you know, you know your friend. Mm. You've been with him for years. And he had lost so much weight and he was really in pain. And but still, we were hoping for a miracle that maybe Barbara would say, "Ah, God, Utuhulagatini is fine," and it didn't happen that way, you know.
And for somebody that you basically grew up with, in your case, I mean, when you were still in Joburg, Alexandra, and going to the U.S. and facing struggles of living in a foreign country, and at the same time looking after yourselves and being creative. Must have been an experience and half. I mean, as I said, you know, those who've interacted with him, he always left a little piece of himself that was positive, as you describe it, and funny moments. Yeah. I cannot think of him in any other way except through that prism. But talk to me about your experiences, you know, briefly with him from then to now.
Well, we started, you know, when I started in this business, I was performing with the Cats and Jammer Kids. There was four of us. We were a quartet. I was 15 years old. And Hugh had started playing with some of the older guys, Elijah Nkwenyana, you know, Brad B.B. You know, as kids, this was not serious stuff, but already we were serious. We wanted to do this.
They allowed you in, so, you know. Yeah.
And so...
So I was in good company.
So with the band that played background for the Woodpeckers, Hugh was also there.
Yes.
And we were, the Cats and Jammer Kids, we were like junior woodpeckers.
Okay.
So any show they would go to, they would have us, so that when they change into another set, then we would take the stage.
Yes.
And Hugh used to play background. That's how we got to know each other at that age, 15.
Yes.
And then we knew each other at 16, 17. And then lo and behold, when we were 19, we joined King Kong. Musical, and that's when now in King Kong the musical we really became professionals, and we were being paid money that was a little better than the 2 shillings and 6 pence that we used to make. And then from then on in King Kong, our friendship really became even tighter.
Yes,
you know, because now we spend the whole year together.
Yes,
you know, I've got pictures where he's. Since we are still young, and he's playing Penny Whistler and all kinds of stuff. And that's him. And all the years that I've known Hugh, I've never seen him really down, you know? I've never really seen him down. We were always, like I said, he's an optimist, always optimist, that life is going to do this. In life, I'm going to do this.
Yes.
And this is what I want to do. And what he really wanted to do was to play that trumpet and play it very well. When he went to the States, that's exactly what he wanted to do.
And he did exactly that. The boy was doing.
That's right. And again, he always believed in South African music, you know. And there were times when I would look at him and say, why do you want to take those old songs, you know, and play them? But you know, he had this thing about, you know, old Mpaqanga, you know, he had it, you know. And I'm glad that he did, because even though sometimes you would say these things are too old, but he believed in these songs.
Yes. Well, I want to fast track a little bit and bring him to after the 90s, where he took to the music that was there, even now, the most recent types of the evolving music, and played with so many different artists, younger artists, and adapted to their music as well as help them adapt to his way of interpreting music. If you can just briefly talk about the way he worked with locally based musicians and influenced them.
I think I mean taking from what Bragazi is saying, I think what Brahu was doing with that music, it was to keep in touch with who he was. Mm. I think that music, for some reason, would maintain his sense of belonging. Mm. Mm. So that you don't feel isolated from everywhere else and you suddenly don't even know who you are. And it was something that kept him in contention for some time. So for some reason, when he came back home, there was that longing. Mm. I want to remember,
yes.
You know, yeah. Where I came from and how I can advance, you know, mm-hmm.
Yes.
This hunger for my being.
Well, his identity clearly comes across in many, besides the music and even in interviews, you know, it was yes. The most important thing. If yeah. You don't recognize who he was, mm. I think he would have issues with you. But there's also the other side of him, of being an outspoken person, generally, whether social or otherwise. But even on the, if you know, humanitarian grounds, all the big issues of the world, he was very outspoken. Mm. Where did that come from? Was it just part of his personality, or was it out of concern?
Wow. So when we left, yeah, we were not very political.
Yes.
You know, in the sense of really being politically astute.
Yes.
But there were a lot of stuff that we noticed and, you know, we acted accordingly. For instance, we had Kipi Moeketsi. Kipi was very political. So he used to talk to us about apartheid, colonialism, and the mining companies, how they were raping the country. Mm. And as youngsters, you look at Kipi, but you didn't understand some of the stuff. So when we got to the U.S., Miriam was already there. And remember that Miriam was persona non grata the day she made that statement at the United Nations. A statement that was written to the Professor Mbekositi, as students, because they were there. And so when Hugh and them got there, all these guys who were students, who were in the ANC and PAC, had skipped the country. And when they had gone there, they had not skipped the country, they just went there, especially Hugh, to study, because he had gotten a scholarship. Miriam had gotten a job. So they were exposed to the real politics, not only of South Africa, but of the rest of the continent, and then the international politics. So by the time I got there in 1964, I found them to be so politically astute, and they were talking international and African and Pan-African and the diaspora in the U.S. and in the Caribbean. Mm. So that's where it came from.
Yeah,
yeah, the injustices of the colonial system, you know, on the colonized peoples and so on. And so he became very, very, very political. So was Miriam.
Yes,
and so all of us.
Yes.
You know.
But at the same time, down to earth and having as much fun as he could. How do you remember him very briefly? Because I'm just about to wrap our conversation.
Well, you know, if you have to speak about remembering, bro, you obviously need to write a book from personal experience.
Absolutely.
And one of the things that I've always known, he was very humorous. Mm. He would make you laugh until you couldn't laugh anymore. He was such a funny man and self-effacing.
Yes.
You know, you'd sit with him and look at himself and start making all those funny faces. I mean, all his colleagues, I'm sure they've borne the brunt of being the comics of Brahim. Mm. But also, you know, he was a humanist. Mm. A lot of people that don't know, yes, Brahu was forthright. At times he could be confrontational, but there was always one thing, he was honest. There was this sense of honesty about things that he said about. I mean, I've had, you know, confrontations with him around certain issues, especially on the drug issue.
Yes.
Mm. We've had really many serious challenges on, you know, at some stage I said, yeah, man, bro, you look at yourself.
Yes.
You are in a better privileged position, because I was challenging him and saying other, you know, other youngsters cannot be in a similar, I shouldn't have said that. I got a bit of education from
Well, I suppose because of this, you know, a broad life that he lived and the contributions that he made, this short interview conversation cannot do justice to the man. Except I say, I think
one of the things that I really think I should actually say. Exile to Bobo Ragazzi, Gwangwa, Hugh and Sisi and Miriam, to a lot of people was just being in exile.
Yes.
But for me, having had a stint of being outside the country, I understood the pain.
Yes. Yeah.
It was deeper than just being away from home with all these bright lights and everything and being
covered
by some of these great guys.
Sure. Mm. Now, Brakase, final word to you, briefly, talking to Bo Masekela. Because in a way, I would suppose they were expecting that you and Rajonas, Sisleta, Memakeba, and so forth, were looking after each other. Final word of a send-off to an old friend.
Well, the final word is that, you know, like I said, he was an optimist. So I did not expect him to go now. Is that we will carry on the job that we all talked about, that we have to carry on and do some of the things of educating our kids, especially when it comes to the arts. So we will carry on, Hugh, don't worry, and then tell Bobraki, Pili Bobramake, we'll be seeing them, but not now.
Thanks very much, Brakate. Recipo. Thank you very much. I
want to concur with Brakate.
Sure.
It's almost like Brakate says something that I had said when Selby had passed on.
Yeah.
I said, you know, the fire you made when the cold wind was blowing will keep on burning.
That's right. Thanks very much for this conversation. And this is a tribute send-off to well-loved, well-known Hugh Masekela, who's no more with us, and the final days before he's taken to his last resting place with Sipho Hotstix Mabuza and Caiphus Semenya.